Good afternoon, dear friends. It's good to see you. And I'm happy to welcome Father Bryan Hehir this afternoon to our convention. Father, you know, is a very good friend to us, to NCEA, as I know he's a good friend to many of you that are here. But Father has a long history with NCEA, and his saying yes to us is indicative of his kind and generous spirit. Father comes to us with a long list of very impressive accomplishment: degrees, honorary degrees, teaching at Georgetown, working at the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, and he served for years as the president of Catholic Charities USA. He's also served on the faculty at the Harvard School of Divinity, where I think you might have been the first Catholic priest to be the dean of the Divinity School. Presently, Father holds an endowed chair at the Kennedy School at Harvard, and he is also the Secretary for Health and Social Services for the Archdiocese of Boston. So today we have the privilege of hearing and learning from him as he helps us understand the connection between the broader context of the church and our work in Catholic education, and then to consider also what that secular characteristic of our society adds to our challenge. But nonetheless, we as educators and catechists know the better understanding we have of our circumstances or the context in which we work, the better we will be able to carry out our ministry. So I'm grateful that Father Hehir is here to help us learn how to do that.
Thank you very much. I am delighted, as Karen said, to be back to an organization that the invitation to give this speech made me think of how long I've been in living contact with NCEA. I had to take a deep breath when I found out how long that was and how old I am, but we just have to put up with those things. As I counted, it goes back to the 1970s when I first went to work at the National Bishops' Conference. This is the second opportunity I've had to provide a keynote address or one of the major addresses at NCEA, and so I am deeply appreciative of this opportunity because I respect so much what this institution stands for and does, and I respect the fact that behind the institution are the men and women, religious and laity, and priests and brothers, who make up the living tradition of Catholic education today. Your theme is the background to my title, which is Defining the Future and Addressing Its Challenges. The way I hope to specify the broader theme you have been examining all week is to lay stress on the context in which Catholic education occurs in our time, the setting, the background, the framework within which we carry on the ancient tradition of the passing on of the faith. Having framed the context, I will spend a little time on the content, although I think most of this week probably was dedicated to the content of what we do, understandably. And so my stress will lie on the setting, but also on the resources, the content of the resources of the faith we have. And I would close with a short reflection on who does the work today and how we do it. When we talk about the context in which we live and work, we always must become specific, a specific culture, a specific country, a specific place. And while that will absorb a good deal of my attention, I suppose it's only appropriate to remember that in the differing contexts in which Catholicism lives, works, and passes on the faith, there is always continuity of content. The teaching church of which you are a part is a phenomenon that can be traced from the Gospels and the New Testament through the ministry of the church to this convention itself. In the Gospels, Jesus is primarily addressed as a teacher, Oftentimes, he, in a sense, talked about the fact that he was a teacher, but you had to keep your eye on what he was teaching rather than him personally. But there was nothing that surpassed the attention he gave to teaching in multiple ways. And then as we trace in the New Testament from the Gospels on to the Acts of the Apostles, the book that we are reading from at each Eucharist during the Easter season, the book that is often called the Gospel of the Holy Spirit, because we trace the development of the church from the upper room on Easter Sunday on through the Mediterranean world to Rome itself. So that Jesus, the teacher, becomes then the Jesus who has left us the kerygma, the central message of the life, death, and ministry of the Lord. And then we move from the kerygma to the didache, the broader teaching of the faith that we find expressed and explained in Paul's epistles. And so then we come to the teaching church. Among its multiple responsibilities, there is none that ranks higher than the teaching ministry. So you are part and parcel of not only something that is essential to the life of the church, but there really is nothing else that outranks it. Even the reverence we give to the sacraments, and particularly to the Eucharist, the sacraments become intelligible to us because of the teaching. Without the teaching, the sacraments would be ritual without content. So Jesus the teacher, the early church and the teaching, and then the church through the centuries as the teaching church. And we come then to this convention and in a sense celebrate the majesty of the ministry at every level of the teaching church. We have to do it differently in the 21st century than they did it in the apostolic church, or they did it in the Middle Ages, or they did it in Europe of the 18th and 19th century. We face different questions, different challenges, different opportunities. But while we do it differently, the doing of the ministry remains identical over time. We have had models of how we have taught here in this country. I can remember a day when I'm literally old enough to remember the Labor Day sermon every Sunday before Labor Day, that the plan of the church in the United States was every Catholic child in a Catholic school. That was the design, and that continued up into the early 60s. In the period since the 1960s, without any less attention to schools, we have come to appreciate just how powerfully important religious education is in terms of the vast numbers of children that are involved in it. And we have come in our understanding of the teaching of the faith to stress ever more the formation in faith over a lifetime, from schools to religious education to formation in faith over a lifetime. The dynamic and the emphasis and the organization changes, but as I've described it, the majesty of the ministry does not change. You are part of the teaching church, and that is a story as old as the New Testament is old in history. The one faith that we teach exists in multiple cultures in our globalized world. And so there is a need to be able to put together being Catholic with a capital C, the identity of the teaching, and being Catholic in specific ways in different cultures and places. So that's what I turn to as I want to stress a bit about the characteristics of the culture and country in which we live and teach, in which we are responsible for passing on the faith, for invigorating the life of the society in which we live. This quotes local church, meaning local in the sense of national. This local church confronts us with five basic characteristics, I will argue. Each one of these characteristics can be seen as an opportunity for ministry, an opportunity for the gospel. And at the same time, following from the title of your convention, each one of these five characteristics is a challenge. While it is an opportunity, it also is a challenge. I like to think of what we're doing this afternoon in light of a phrase from the Second Vatican Council's document on the Church in the Modern World. Even though that document is now close to 50 years old, it is a powerful, powerful guide to the life of the Church. It tried to take a realistic view of the world in which the Church of the mid-20th century lived, and then to ask what kind of opportunity and challenge that world offered. And one of the phrases that you find in that text is simply this. It says that the Church finds the best way to respect the culture in which it exists by entering into dialogue with that culture, by being willing to engage the secular, if you will, with the sacred, to engage the empirical with the normative, to engage cultural pluralism with a faith that is rich enough to identify with and enrich various cultures. What are the five characteristics that American society, at least in my view, offers us as both an opportunity and a challenge? The first is a secular state. The second is a pluralistic society. The third is a liberal culture. The fourth is a market economy, and the fifth is being a global power. Now, none of this sounds very theological, and I admit it isn't, but the fact of the matter is, when we talk about what we are trying to do, we are trying to shape a community of the faithful that is ready to live in this kind of culture, that sees it as both an opportunity to learn from and an opportunity in which to teach and witness. I think the tone of Gaudium et Spes, the Church in the Modern World, the tone of that document is what I've always called confident modesty. Confident modesty. The Church believes it is confident enough that it has something to say to this place, this society, and this country. And the Church is modest enough, when we're at our best, modest enough to believe we have something to learn from this society, this culture. So let's look quickly at opportunities and challenges that arise from each of these characteristics. The secular state. This is what we mean when we talk about the First Amendment to the Constitution, the so-called religion clauses in the First Amendment. The religion clauses say, to remind you of your high school civics, that Congress shall make no establishment of religion, and it shall not prohibit the free exercise of religion. Now, those two clauses have meant what we have come to call the separation of church and state. Now, that was a new phenomenon for Catholicism when it came into being in the 18th century. A church that had grown from the Mediterranean culture of the Roman Empire into the medieval Res Publica Christiana, Christian Republic of the Middle Ages, and on through the rise of the sovereign state in Europe in the 17th century, that church had come to think of its existence vis-a-vis the state in a way in which it desired special treatment from the state. If there were a majority of Catholics in the culture and in the society, the thought was the church should receive favoritism. But the 18th century, the French Revolution, and more importantly for us, the American Revolution, brought about the modern understanding of religious freedom. And that understanding of religious freedom was that in this society, the power of the state should not be placed in the service of any single religious group, or even in the service of religion as opposed to those who do not believe. And so there was a new phenomenon that faced Catholicism. And it took us basically two centuries to come in principle to an accommodation to this. We find it in the document on religious liberty of Vatican II. That document, appropriately enough, was authored by an American theologian, John Courtney Murray. But what is the challenge and the opportunity of a secular state? Well, the challenge is that we come to understand ourselves and have understood ourselves in this country as a church in a way that means that we would expect neither favoritism from the state nor any discrimination against us because we're a religious community. So the separation of church and state is precisely this idea that we should expect neither favoritism nor discrimination. That leaves us with the following challenge. What the First Amendment does is leave us free to function as a church. We will not be inhibited, or should not be, and if we are inhibited, we need to speak up about it. We're doing some of that now on certain issues. But the point is, in principle, what the First Amendment and the secular state means, that we will be free to function. And so the challenge is we will be only as effective as the quality of our witness to what we believe. The quality of our witness, our ability to explain it, our ability to share it, our ability to live up to the standards in which we believe and put them on display for the society to learn from or at least to examine. The first challenge, the secular state. The second challenge is a pluralistic society. Now, the first two of these, the secular state and the pluralistic society, are tied together. If you guarantee the freedom of religion of every citizen and of all religious communities, as we do, if you guarantee that in the law, you will produce a society of many religions. So the secular state and the First Amendment virtually guarantee the kind of religious pluralism that marks the United States. We are probably the second most pluralistic society in the world, India being likely the first most pluralistic society. At last count, we estimate 1,100 different denominations and religious communities in this country. Now, what is the challenge and the opportunity of religious pluralism? Well, the first is simply living with pluralism. So we live in the midst of people whom we respect deeply, know them as neighbors, colleagues, professionals. We live and work with people for whom our deepest beliefs are often for them unintelligible. They are not of our faith, they may not be of any faith. And so there is the question, inevitably, that comes up that when we take what we believe is the deepest reality of our life, our faith, we wonder why it doesn't impact others in the same way. I'll come back to this, but that's the first challenge. The second challenge of a religiously pluralistic society is that while we differ in religious terms, we are held together by a common citizenship. And therein lies the next challenge of religious pluralism. When we are divided by visions of faith, when we, in a sense, do not agree on the basic questions in life, the challenge of a pluralistic society is, if you disagree on the ultimate questions of life, can we form a proximate agreement that can undergird our law and policy? This, as you know, is a very challenging moment in which to ask ourselves that question. When we disagree on the ultimate questions in life, is it possible to fashion law and policy on a range of issues, on life and death, on poverty and wealth, on equality and inequality? Is it possible to fashion a moral core that undergirds our law and policy? This is the challenge that we face. At the personal level, it is living in the midst of many faiths and asking questions about what others believe or don't believe, and perhaps more urgently asking questions about why our deepest convictions do not always impact others. But the second challenge is how you fashion a moral foundation for law and policy when we disagree on perhaps the deepest questions in life, where we have come from, where we're going, and how we should live along the way. So questions of what is true and not true, what is right as opposed to what is wrong, what is good to be sought as opposed to evil that can corrupt. These issues cut across social justice, they cut across bioethics, and they cut across questions of peace and security whenever we are threatened, as we have been in the first decade of this century. A secular state and a pluralistic society. The third challenge is a liberal culture. What is the meaning of a liberal culture? Capital L, the liberal tradition. The liberal tradition has had an enormous impact in the founding documents of American society and in our culture since then. The meaning of a liberal culture is how you organize the society around the maximization of freedom for individuals. Think of the Bill of Rights, freedom of religion, freedom of conscience, freedom of speech, freedom of association. We come in this tradition to understand rights as immunities, as protections against interference. So when you define a right, religion, conscience, speech, association, when you define a right as an immunity, you're really saying you draw a circle around a person, and within that circle, they are free to function, free to speak, free to think, free to join whatever organization. Now, a liberal culture offers both opportunities and profound challenges to a Catholic conception of life. First of all, in Catholic teaching, while we value freedom, we also argue it ought to be balanced by other values. John the 23rd, in the encyclical Pacem in Terris, argued that there were four values that had to be the foundation of a good society: freedom, justice, truth, and love. And so we never think of organizing a society only on the basis of freedom. And that at times brings us into conflict with others who seek to value freedom as a kind of singular value. There is an even deeper challenge that comes from a liberal culture. The idea of rights as immunities, protection from interference, that lays stress on the notion that what you mean by freedom is freedom from. Freedom from interference by the state, freedom from interference by other groups in society. Catholic teaching is going to also say we have to balance freedom from with what we learn from St. Paul's letter to the Galatians. In Galatians, Paul talks about freedom for rather than freedom from. So freedom from protects you protects the citizen for space in which they are to live. But freedom for is a somewhat deeper challenge. St. Paul says we have been set free for love. We have been set free to engage one another. So once again, there is an opportunity in understanding freedom from. It helped teach the Catholic Church the meaning, the modern meaning of religious freedom. Again, John Courtney Murray, the author of the Declaration on Religious Liberty at Vatican II, Murray argued that the experience of the church in the United States is not a model for everywhere. That wasn't his argument. But it was, he said, a teaching moment that helped the church come to a clear definition of what religious freedom is. How do we balance freedom, truth, justice, and love in the creation of a society? How do we form citizens that can treasure freedom from we all need space, but match it with freedom for. The fourth dimension of American society, a market economy. What do we mean by this? Well, basically, we mean the dynamic of freedom is the fundamental drive of the way we organize our productivity and the possibility of creation of an ever better life in our economic society. Once again, an opportunity and a challenge. John Paul II, who was raised in a command economy that did not value freedom at all, did not value the market, John Paul II talked about the value of a market economy. He said it protected human freedom from the intrusion of the state. It fostered innovation. And when it worked properly, it helped with the rational allocation of resources. But, once again, the but. But, he said, a market economy by itself, while it can guarantee productivity and aggregate wealth, does not necessarily guarantee distributive justice, does not necessarily attend to the kind of support system that is necessary and required by the dignity of every human person. So we can appreciate the value of this economy, but we have also seen its vulnerability over the last 5 years, both in its very structure, where it came perilously close to certain kinds of collapse, but also in terms of its consequences. Certainly, as you've experienced the teaching of young people, whether in schools or religious education, I suspect you've experienced also the impact of the financial collapse and the very slow recovery since that time. There are stories and statistics that are really stunning about this question of what it takes for a society to rebuild. Here in Boston, at one of our food pantries in Dorchester, in the year 2008, 2009, we were giving out about 5,000 pounds of food a month to help people through the month. We now distribute 47,000 pounds of food a month because that's the increase in need that has occurred. And the impact is also seen by the fact that people who have been our donors are now people who need our help. So this notion of a market economy that produces aggregate wealth is also something that requires more than just freedom. It must match freedom with justice. It must, as we foster appropriate freedom in innovation and productivity, it must be matched with the notions of Catholic teaching of the common good, the good of everyone and not just some, and the option for the poor, that as we care for the good of everyone, there needs to be a weighted concern for the most vulnerable. Competition is inevitable and fruitful when used in a proper framework, but it is insufficient to be a guiding principle of a good society. A secular state, a pluralistic society, a liberal culture, a market economy, and a global power. We are a global power, and for the foreseeable future, we will be one. It is the legacy of this country since the end of World War II, and it will be our immediate future. The U.S. role in the world is more limited, perhaps, now than it was 20 years ago, but the fact of the matter is, no nation impacts the world as a whole more substantially than this nation does. But power, we are taught in Catholic teaching, needs moral direction. So the very power we possess, whether we think of it as military power or economic power or cultural power, power by itself has its own logic. It does not have its own ethic. The logic of power is that it can be coercive and it can be productive, but in either case, it must be guided by a larger moral framework. And so we inevitably, because of our role in the world, we inevitably are trying to educate citizens to help us as a country think about the limits of power and the direction of power that must be sustained. Once again, my guess is your experience in teaching over the last 10 to 15 years probably has brought you into direct contact with young men and young women who, over the last decade of two long, divisive in many ways, wars since 9/11, have meant that some of your students are now people for whom you pray, who have given their lives for the country, and or have seen their fathers, their mothers, their relatives die for the security of the country. It has been, in a sense, a sobering experience to live through the period since 9/11, not only the shock of 9/11, but also when we responded, and responded in the form of a war in Afghanistan that it, at the time, was certainly necessary to respond to the attack. The divisive war in Iraq, I think, had much less justification for it. But in either case, the fact of the matter was that although the country went to war, the people who bore the burden of it were a slice of the country. We have a volunteer force now. And so it was those individuals and their families. Now, all I mean here is not a digression from my theme. It is to say, when you're a global power, there are large choices for the country and its citizens, and the education of that citizenry for American Catholics means trying to understand, again, the opportunities and challenges of this country and how Catholic teaching can be brought to bear as a contribution of the common good. I've now gone through the five characteristics. They are the setting beyond the classroom. We teach at multiple levels, from pre-K through university, and we teach in multiple ways in the church in this country. The context which we face does not set our agenda. Our agenda is set by the scriptures and by the faith of the church. But the context we face does make us recognize what a challenge it is to carry on Catholic education in this kind of setting. Let me talk much more briefly about the content of which we are called, by which we are called to teach, being Catholic in this culture. I think as we think about the education that Catholics live by, if you will, at every level, there is an identifiable Catholic style. There's a Catholic style for understanding what we teach and how we teach. That Catholic style, I think, is made up of the relationship of faith and reason. It is made up of the relationship of an evangelical and ecclesial faith, and it is made up of an understanding of the moral life which combines humanity and holiness. These are characteristics of what we teach rather than specific items. Faith and reason for us are complementary. We believe that faith can take us beyond reason. It never falls beneath reason. We believe that whether we're talking about science or politics or economics or medicine, there is a way in which our deepest conviction of faith can be translated into the language of reason so that we can both explain not only what we believe, but why we believe it, and we can offer that belief to the wider society in which we live. Faith and reason, as Benedict XVI constantly reminds us, is a characteristic of Catholic understanding. Faith can take us beyond reason, but faith should never fall beneath reason. We have a faith that is evangelical and ecclesial. Since the Second Vatican Council, the use of the scriptures at every level of the church is one of the most noticeable characteristics of the life of Catholicism. But we are not a purely evangelical church. We are evangelical and ecclesial, which means that it is the life of the church to carry on what is called the development of doctrine. We never go away from the scriptures, but there is a way in which we go beyond them in a positive sense, as we seek to relate them to the culture around us, the culture I've tried to describe. And when we think of the moral life, while holiness gives us the vision, the full vision of the scriptures, we also believe that it is possible to strive for, once again, a common moral foundation among people of many faiths and no faith. So almost all of our moral teaching can be expressed both in the language of faith, but also explained in the language of reason. Once again, seeking to create a community of the faith in a secular pluralistic society means we need to put together faith and reason, humanity and holiness, as a constant obligation. What kind of sources do we draw upon to put these things together? In the year ahead, we will have a unique opportunity. 2012 is the 50th anniversary of the opening of the Second Vatican Council. Now, Catholicism never forgets its history, and so the council did not fall out of the sky or, in the opinion of some, emerge from hell. The council is in line with the tradition of Catholicism. For us, history and contemporary experience go together. There is no present for us without a recognition of our past, and there is no future for us without continued growth in the life of faith. Again, to quote Murray, the tradition of the church is a tradition with a growing edge, a growing, developing experience of faith. If one looks at the Vatican Council, we will be reminded during this year again and again of its richness. And it is important to remember that councils in the church tend to affect the church for centuries. If you think of the Baltimore Catechism, it grew directly out of the Council of Trent 4 centuries earlier, mediated by the Council of Baltimore. But if you look at Vatican II, therefore, although it is 50 years old, it is a blink of an eyelash in the life of Catholicism. As we carry on the teaching ministry, this year can and should be a fruitful year. The Holy Father has combined the notion of the Council with the 20th anniversary of the Catechism of the Catholic Faith. And those two ideas together give us an opportunity to, in a sense, review and deepen our sense of the life of the Church in the 21st century, nourished by a long tradition, but nourished specifically by the teaching of Vatican II. As we try to communicate the faith, it is important to recognize, I think, that we face a double challenge. There is the outer challenge of trying to communicate, again, with those of many faiths and no faith, and there is now an inner challenge, I think, in the life of the church, in the experience of the last 10 years. The outer challenge is the question of why people may not believe. What is it that prevents someone from seeing the light and the truth that is so deeply powerful to us? I always try and get inside the mind of people whom I respect deeply, but who basically just represent a view of the world that is quite different. Let me give you 3 quick examples. Of people who have struggled with faith: Camus, Dostoevsky, and Gandhi. Camus had an intellectual problem with faith. Camus, the Nobel Prize-winning author of the French of France, the voice of the French Resistance, Camus once said, "If God did exist, we would have to destroy him." And what he meant by that was, in his eyes, faith kept people adolescents. That we handed over the hardest problems in life, from suffering to injustice to death itself, to God, that God would solve them. And so we didn't take responsibility as human beings for the world. What answers Camus? Well, I don't know if it would answer him convincingly, but it seems to me Camus' challenge means there must be an adult faith as the goal of all of our teaching. A faith that knows not only what it believes, but why it believes it. a faith that can engage in conversation with those who start from different premises, but upon whom cooperation is necessary. Dostoevsky had a moral challenge. He said, the death of one innocent child is enough to destroy belief in God. Now, Dostoevsky knew about the innocent children that died perhaps in Moscow or in the rural parts of Russia. But Dostoevsky's challenge is deeply intensified in our day because we know about innocent children dying all over the world. CNN presents it to us in dramatic color. But Dostoevsky's question is the ancient question. How can a God of compassion create and allow a world that we see around us so often as contradiction? For us, the answer always, I think, must be, is that God works through the human. God allows evil in the world. He does not create it. But God does create us as responsible human beings with a capacity to try to shape a world that is less a contradiction to the goodness of God. Indeed, it is interesting that Camus was once asked to speak to a group of Dominicans in Paris and at the end of World War II. And he came and spoke of the problem of suffering and how he dealt with it as an agnostic. And at the end of the talk, he said, it may not be possible for us to create a world in which no innocent children suffer. But it is possible to create a world in which fewer innocent children suffer. And if we look to the Christians and don't find help, where else will we go? Others watch us because of what we believe. Dostoevsky challenges us. And Gandhi challenged us even more strongly. After a first trip through the West, they said to Gandhi, "What's your experience of the West?" He said, "I like your Christ, but I don't like your Christians." And that is the problem, not intellectual or moral. That is the problem of lack of performance, that Jesus promises so much by his life that we are constantly under pressure to approximate him. So we need to educate in a way that grounds us in an adult faith, engages us in moral commitment, and helps us to strive to close the gap between Jesus and ourselves. The inner challenge we face as a church, I'm sure you have felt. The consequence of the last decade, the crisis of the sex abuse, has had as its predominant consequence, I think, the loss of trust. Loss of trust between the people of the church and the leadership, loss of trust at a civil level between society and the church. We cannot simply remain with these gaps. It is going to be necessary to continue the struggle we have undertaken in the last 10 years. It is going to be necessary to carry on our education with a threefold objective: to deepen the faith in those who possess it and enhance their trust. Secondly, to heal the faith of those who have entered into a rupture of faith and have left or been driven from the church. And thirdly, to share the faith with those who do not yet possess it. The who and the how, very briefly, of this whole enterprise. Knowing what the challenges are, understanding that we have powerful resources from the Second Vatican Council, from the new evangelization, from the year of faith ahead, powerful resources to work with. In the end, however, in the end, the transmission of the faith is dependent upon people who are possessed by a vision and a direction of life that they can share. Vatican II, in a sense, called us to think of ourselves together as the church, different vocations, different states of life, but a single community committed to witness to the gospel. I talked earlier about the fact that we've changed our focus, the way in which we think about how education is carried on. We treasure and value our schools. We treasure equally religious education, and we are all faced with the challenge of formation and faith. All of this requires what the Council called for, not only how we relate to each other, as priests, religious, and laity, but how we work together. That has already occurred in education. The gratitude we owe the sisters will never be fulfilled, for centuries they were the foundation of the life of faith in the church, and they continue to be, but in smaller numbers. But the transition to lay leadership that has gone on in Catholic education now must become a kind of model for the transition we're going to need in pastoral life in the church. Declining numbers of priests mean an ever-increasing role for the laity. It's already been done in Catholic education in many ways. It has to be expanded and broadened. Who will do this? We need continuing work on partnership. And what do we do? How do we do it? What we seek, I think, are two things. We talk often about Catholic identity of our institutions, how they can be in the midst of civil society and yet grounded in faith. It is equally important to talk about Catholic identity at the very personal level in a society that is secular, pluralistic, and liberal, an identity that is grounded. But in the midst of all of that grounding, in the midst of the challenges we face, we cannot lose sight of the opportunities we face. So what we seek to educate is those with an engaged, mature faith, where people are grounded in what they know and are capable of witnessing to it and sharing it with others. To return to Camus, many people watch us precisely because of what we proclaim. It is the challenge of Catholic education to create a community that is worthy of what we proclaim and what we are called to be by the Master himself. Thank you very much.
Thank you for standing to acknowledge the great resource that Father O'Hare has been to us and the great wisdom that he shared with us. So let's now just kind of stay where we are, take a little stretch, and then liturgy will begin with Bishop Arthur Kennedy as our celebrant and some very special music. So stretch, but don't leave us, okay? Thank you.
like to invite the people who are seated up in the balcony. If you'd like to receive communion, we'd invite you to come downstairs today, simply because we're a smaller group and we're only going to be distributing communion at the front of the sanctuary. So those of you who are seated in the balcony, we'd invite you to come down for communion. Thank you.
As so, as I so. the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do.
Through my fault, through my most grievous fault.
Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary and the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who gave us the Paschal mystery in the covenant you established for reconciling the human race, so dispose our minds, we pray, that what we celebrate by professing the faith, we may express in deeds. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. After the crippled man had been cured, while Peter and John were still speaking to the people, the priests, the captain of the temple guard, and the Sadducees confronted them. Disturbed that they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead, they laid hands on Peter and John and put them in custody until the next day, since it was already evening. But many of those who heard the word came to believe, and the number of men grew to about 5,000. On the next day, their leaders, elders, and scribes were assembled in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly class. They brought them into their presence and questioned them, "By what power or by what name have you done this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, answered them, "Leaders of the people and elders, if we are being examined today about a good deed done to a cripple, namely by what means he was saved, then all of you and all the people of Israel should know that it was in the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. In his name, this man stands before you healed. He is the stone rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. There is no salvation through anyone else, nor is there any other name under heaven given to the human race by which we are to be saved." The word of the Lord.
Let us rejoice and be glad. The Lord be with you. A reading of the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus revealed himself again to his disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. He revealed himself in this way. Together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, Zebedee's sons, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We also will come with you." So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. When it was already dawn, Jesus was standing on the shore, but the disciples did not realize it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, have you caught anything to eat?" They answered him, "No." So he said to them, "Cast the net over the right side of the boat, and you will find something." So they cast it, and were not able to pull it in because of the number of fish. So the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he tucked in his garment, for he was lightly clad, and jumped into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, for they were not far from the shore, only about 100 yards, dragging the net with the fish. When they climbed out on shore, they saw a charcoal fire with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you just caught." So Simon Peter went over and dragged the net ashore, full of 153 large fish. Even though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come, have breakfast." And none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they realized it was the Lord. Jesus came over and took the bread and gave it to them, and in a like manner the fish. This was now the third time Jesus was revealed to his disciples after being raised from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord.
Let me express my gratitude to all of you for the invitation to be with you today to celebrate Mass with you as you come to the conclusion of your conference. This is a wonderful gathering because, especially during the celebration of Easter week, we come to a realization of what it is that the Lord provides for us as his gifts in allowing us to share in the mediation of the mysteries which he has given to us through our faith and to our understanding and to our practice. I've been fortunate to be engaged in the same kind of ministries that you have engaged in for many years, having taught for 30 years in theology at the University of St. Thomas, and now finishing my 5 years as rector of St. John's Seminary here in Boston. I know that the members of the archdiocese, the bishops and the priests, religious and the laity, are very much delighted to have had you here for this convention. The archdiocese is so deeply committed in its ways to all of the same kind of tasks that you undertake in your dioceses throughout the country. Many schools for children ages from 5 up through the university life, ways in which they are able to come into contact with the mystery of faith in relationship to their growth, which is not only a growth in terms of knowledge, but a growth in terms of their hearts, their affections, and their imagination, so that they can become always closer to the mystery of Christ. The pattern of the liturgical readings after the celebration of Christ's resurrection from the dead on Easter Sunday present us with the unfolding consequences of that event of the resurrection. And the readings reveal to us, in the first instance, a manner in which the resurrection shapes both the personal living of Christ's followers and how, through their understanding and decisive actions, the early responses that were given to that mystery, first engendered in the consciousnesses of the apostles a way in which their own lives would be reshaped, and that they would now begin to grow in a new way through a conversion into Christian faith and hope and charity. Thus, these teachings of the effects of the resurrection, both personally and also institutionally, can provide considerable assistance to us as we are present at a conference such as this, which affirms that its members seek to continue those effects in the lives of all of those who are educated in preparation for a way of life, but not only for a way of life, but for a participation in the religious and the civil institutions by which human meaning is most significantly advanced. As well as maintaining a mission of its own integrity in the Catholic Educational Association, also provides great assistance to those who are involved in the understanding of the faith so that it is able to be presented to them in such a way that they themselves, learning it, will be able to become witnesses to others. Caring, therefore, both for individuals as well as the multiple facets of institutions, such an enormous enterprise as this brings forth not only exchanges that are so essential in human life, exchanges of grace that build up and elevate nature, exchanges of intelligence replacing ignorance, exchanges of the good that replaces darkness, all of this shaping people in such a way that it becomes a certain paideia, as the Greeks spoke of it, a way of having a whole life that is able to be known and able to be guided through the mystery of God's revelation and his faith and his presence. It is important, then, that we understand the great mission that we share together. For that mission is the one that is given to us by Christ, and it is one which is of great importance in the life of the church and in the life of those to whom we have been entrusted as guarantors and as guides of their faith and of their learning, whether it is in the classroom or whether it is in a parish basement teaching catechetics, or whether it is teaching others how to be able to become themselves agents and future teachers so that they will be able to continue what has begun in you and in the whole life of the church. Catholic education is always rooted in the mystery of Christ's death and resurrection as the reason and goal of all its energies. From all those who are engaged in education in classrooms, in administration, in athletic programs, in the care of resources, financial and physical, in the lunchrooms and dining halls, in the boarding places and dormitories, in the offices of presidents and rectors, and of course in the offices of campus ministry, so many different ways in which the mystery of the mystical body is established by the work that is done through those who are members of this organization. The readings of the Easter season provide the patterns which allow us insights into the way of God's work, his mercy, and his redemption. These days, we have listened into the accounts in Acts, the Acts of the Apostles, about the place of the followers of Christ in mediating the miracles that he himself had once undertaken. Consider the miracle of the healing of the crippled man. Had they not observed their Lord address this very matter in the healing of a paralytic? Today, in the reading, we hear about the recognition that Peter has when he is brought to give an account of what agency he operates in the transformation of bringing healing where there had been disease. In whose name is this done? By what power, he is asked. Now, we find Peter, when brought before the religious authorities, not only concerned about the healing, but providing explanations of the deeds that the apostles have been doing. And they, through that same power that Jesus had manifested in his resurrection, is the same power that has been granted to them to be engaged in the miracle of the healing of the cripple. The actions and then the words are no longer then merely private events, but now as Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, speaks, these have entered into the institutional and cultural worlds where facts and meanings of faith are now identified and witnessed to and named. The spoken word always is the outer manifestation of the interiority or the inner word that the apostles now have taken over from their Lord. The outer word is now their lives. The outer word manifests what the inner word of God truly is. The first step in this pattern, then, is the miracles that come through the power of God and the faith that accompanies those miracles in the apostles. The second step is the deepening conversion that is ongoing in the apostles and in the other disciples as Jesus appears to them, as he appears to the women, to the travelers on the road to Emmaus, and today, as we hear, he appears to Peter and other disciples who are with him. It is an interesting matter in this account of Peter, as different from the first reading today, is that we hear a certain resonance of the difficulty that Peter is having in relationship to the fact that his Lord is not immediately there with him all the time. Peter decides that he's going to go back to his old work, the work that he did before Christ had called him. "I am going fishing," he announces. "We will also come with you," say the others. it's almost as if nothing had happened, and that there would be no longer an ability to follow Christ, and so they returned to what they had left behind. The voice of Jesus follows them. They hear it as they are out in the boat, unable to catch any fish. The voice of Jesus follows them, and they hear it asking them if they have caught anything. No, they answer. Cast the net on the other side of the boat, they are told. This, of course, is rather useless information for fishermen, because the fish swim under the boat as well. But it had just enough substance to provide a remembrance of the intervention of Christ in the work of the fishermen when Peter first heard the voice say to him that he wanted them to put out to the sea again after they had been fishing all night and to drop their nets into the deep. Luke chapter 5. It was the voice that Peter knew from the call to his conversion that drew him to follow Christ in the first place. It drew him more and more into the interiority of the one whom he had loved as his Lord. And now, hearing the voice, he does not even have to ask. He tells the others, "It is the Lord," and they go ashore. And we do not hear again about Peter going fishing. The important dimensions of this pattern that we find then, not only does it give us miracle and a deepening of conversion, but conversion also brings about consolation, a consolation that allows us to be able to discover a deeper self-knowledge, a self-knowledge that Peter now has as that conversion continues to grow. It is the kind of thing that, of course, can happen to us through our faith and through our conversion and through the consolations that can come to us, even as we know how the mystery of the resurrection is able to overcome the suffering and the mystery of death. We are called once more to enter into a way in which consolation allows grace to be capable of helping us to remember voices, to remember readings, to remember especially persons who had called us to be a member of Christ's church and to be ones to follow him and to make sacrifices so that the mystery of his work could be accomplished and to work together, to be integrated together so that we know that what we do, each differently and each at different levels, is capable of making such a difference, not only in our personal lives, but in the institutions within which we live, including, of course, the institution of the church herself, but also the institutions of the world, who desperately need to hear some word of healing and some message of hope. Together, our gifts in the church and its mission have always been received in a way that acknowledges the wonderful achievements and graces that accompany them. The importance of what we do also means we must be grateful and filled with gratitude because of the fact that God has given us the grace and power that we need in order to be able to follow him and to love him and especially to draw others to him. Always conversions, always inviting others into the conversions, teaching others to understand how it is that they can grow themselves into a mystery which will give them consolation and joy and peace. And always there is the opening of our lives to the gifts of God's consolation and presence with us, the ways in which he provides us his mercy, and his love, offering them as conditions which we are also able to bring forth to the young and to the adults whom we teach and form. Thus, the effect of the resurrection, as it enters into the lives of those who have faith in the Lord, can be mediated in so many ways, can carry his name and his work and his redemption to all of those whose lives we touch. One of the most wonderful manifestations of interiority and consolation, I think, that we can have as a model for ourselves in the power of the gift of faith and the power of mercy that was so much a gift and so much touched, oh, our beloved St. Augustine. Augustine, in chapter 7 of his Confessions, talks about the enormous transformation that has taken place in his life, in his heart, in his learning, in his desires, and he wonders how it was that he had not been able to recognize these before. But it's an example of the deepening of conversion and the consolation that flows from it. He writes, "I looked for a way to gain strength, the strength I needed to enjoy you, but I did not find it until I embraced the mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who is also God, supreme over all things and blessed forever. He called out, proclaiming, 'I am the way and the truth and the life.' Nor had I known him as the food, which though I was not yet strong enough to eat it, he had mingled with our flesh, for the Word became flesh, so that wisdom, through whom you created all things, might become for us the milk adapted to our infancy. Late have I loved you, beauty ever ancient, ever new. Late have I loved you. You were within me, but I was outside, and it was there that I searched for you. In my unloveliness, I plunged into the lovely things which you created. You were with me, but I was not with you. Created things kept me from you, yet if they had not been in you, they would not have been at all. You called, you shouted, you broke through my darkness. You flashed, you shone, you dispelled my blindness. You breathed your fragrance on me. I drew in breath, and now I pant for you. I have tasted you, now I hunger and thirst for more. You touched me, and I burned for your peace." Thus we may know the mystery of conversion and consolation that draws us into the unity with Christ, that brings us all of the gifts that he promises to us in the mystery of his resurrection from the dead.
Let us pray. O loving God, we turn to you, asking you to hear us as we once again seek you.
For all members of the church, that as the risen Savior shines upon us today, we take our joyful Alleluia out into the world, banished darkness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who hold and teach our Catholic faith, that we may endeavor to spread it with the same vigor and enthusiasm as did the apostles, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially members of our school and parish families, that they enjoy the eternal presence of Mary and her risen Son, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us gathered here today, striving to be faithful to Christ in our daily lives, that the joy of the resurrection renew and strengthen us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. O Lord, we ask you to hear all of the prayers that we have spoken and those of our hearts, so that we may always be able to know that through our intercession with you, we are able to touch your will. And we ask you also to help us to know the intercession of our Blessed Lady and her intervention for us before the Lord, as we say together her prayer. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death.
Praise God in the place of his glory. Sing praise.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all of his holy church.
Perfect within us, O Lord, we pray, the solemn exchange brought about by these paschal offerings, that we may be drawn from earthly desires to a longing for the things of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to our Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord. But in this time, above all, to laud you more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, and by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." the mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray you, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Benedict, our Pope, and Sean, our Bishop, the order of bishops and all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. Live forever, reign forever and ever. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Let us pray. Keep safe, O Lord, we pray, those whom you have saved by your kindness, that redeemed by the passion of your Son, they may rejoice in his resurrection, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Before the final blessing, I just want to extend thanks to all of those who have been so wonderful in the work that they did in making possible this convention. And I know that the offices in Washington, Karen Ristow, and the people in her office, and here in Boston, the Archdiocese, who have worked so hard to prepare for this. And we are so grateful for all of you who have come here as, in a sense, a sign to us of the mystery of God's work in so many other places. And pray that you will all now be able to go safely home. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace. Alleluia, Alleluia.
A round of applause for the wonderful choir and Paul Kelly. Fantastic. May I ask you to sit for one moment? We must pass the torch on.
Thank you all very much.
First of all, there are some people I must thank, Karen Ristow and the NCEA, for their support, their foresight, and their belief that we can, as 11 dioceses, pull this together. And the superintendents and all their staff who stand here with me, for their enthusiasm, their energy,
and for their perseverance through everything. Thank you so much. In the Archdiocese of Boston, there are two people we would also like to recognize, Sheila Kustis and Martha McCook. Thank you so much for making a dream a possibility and a reality. All of you here today for speaking with one voice about Catholic education. It couldn't be better than that. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Now, with Godspeed, we wish Houston to please reap the blessing that we have experienced for working cooperatively to serve the Lord through planning this convention. Most importantly, please remember to make friends in Houston and to have fun in Houston. And now we would like to, as we pass the torch, to have Sister Keating come forward. We all want to shake your hand and wish you luck. So one by one, here we go, Sister. We're going to start. We're going to start with Mary. Just a shake of a hand and good luck. Ladies and gentlemen, it's all Houston's.
Howdy. Thank you, Margaret. Hasn't Boston and the New England states done a superb job? Let's hear it for them. And all the NCEA office. I'm pleased to be joined here by representatives from Region 10, Arkansas, Oklahoma, and real Texans. So we're fixing to welcome you to Texas, Houston in particular. At this time next year, we reckon you should come. So y'all come, all y'all come. All y'all is plural for everyone, you know. You see, I wasn't born in Texas, but I got there as soon as I could, and you could do the same thing next year. Every educator wants to make history, and they want to be part of a first. So here's your splendid opportunity. It's the first time ever that we will have NCEA in Texas. So be part of the first and get yourself there. Y'all come. Tell your neighbors and your friends to come. We don't have any space issues in Texas. It's a very large state, so come one and all. And remember, the place to be seen in 2013 is deep in the heart of Texas. We'll pray and we'll have sessions and we'll do all those good things NCEA does, but we also plan to party. I guess I should be saying party because I'm in Boston. We really like to party and to enjoy ourselves, so we plan to do that. It'll be a little bit country, a little bit Irish, a little bit Western and a little bit Irish, and, you know, a little bit cowboy and everything and a little bit Irish. Did I say that? Our students insisted on being part of welcoming you, so now they're going to join us and welcome you to Houston next year. Stay. Y'all come.
Safe travels home, and we'll see you in Houston.